Blog Talk Radio.
When you're born in this world, you're given a ticket to the freak show. And when you're born in America, you're given a front row seat.
And the daylight was heavy with thunder, with the smell of the rain on the...
I'll tell you what I think. The cocksuck and the elite who own and run everything in this fucking country are selling it out from under us tomorrow.
Forget the politicians. The politicians are put there to give you the idea that you have freedom of choice. You don't. You have no choice. You have owners. They own you.
Here comes that rainbow again.
There's dick jokes coming up. Please relax.
They got you by the balls.
Let's do this.
Okay, what up, freaks? Yes, let us begin. Let us begin, as always, with a glorious and rousing F.U. Huh? Yes, indeed, F.U. Freaks unite. I am your host, Steve Crafty Crafts, coming to you live from FEMA Region 1. And I'll let you figure that one out on your own. I can't do everything for you. I do have some bad news, unfortunately. I did miss a little bit of my pre-show ritual, and I did not have my chicken wings. So, you know, we're a little off here. Don't worry, you know, still had my pint of vodka and my double barrel chocolate mescaline, so we're hoping that's enough to see us through. All right, now, of course, FEMA Region 1, I will give it to you. That is the area formerly known as New England. And can you believe that we are almost at the end of summer here? Holy shit. I know technically we got another month, you know, but let's face it. After Labor Day, summer's over, right? That's it. It's fucking crazy. And this summer, man, I tell you, it was just a blur of tear gas and ice buckets. Jesus, these two things alone have me screaming for fall. Seriously, bring on the fall in a good old fashioned market crash or something. What's up with that, huh? Doesn't seem like all the big shit happens in fall. Am I right? Not all of it. It seems like a fair amount of the stuff happens in the fall time months, right? I mean, go way back. Stock market crash at 29, fall. Pearl Harbor, technically fall, right? December 7th. That's still fall, motherfuckers. JFK, fall. The Iranian hostages taken in the fall, November 4th. 9/11, all right. A little bit early, but again, it was after fucking Labor Day, so I'm counting it. What else you have? Oh, according to her own testimony, Monica Lewinsky, she started playing Hide the Stogie in the Oval Office with Slick Willie. Mm-hmm. And, of course, you can't forget the last financial fiasco fuck show. That pretty much came to a head in October of 08. Hurricane Sandy. And, of course, you have the day that officially, in my opinion, the music really did die. I know that people will point to the plane crash of Buddy Holly, but it had a few more good years in it, in my opinion. And, no, it was actually when the band played their last concert, The Last Waltz, on Turkey Day of 1976. Jesus, fall sucks. Used to like the damn thing, but I could only imagine what is coming. Shit, of course, is that was my dog, by the way, in the background. Yes, we have got ourselves a new four-legged friend, And in case he pipes up again during the show, he's generally not been a barker, but he does have occasionally yaps in him. But anyway, you can certainly welcome to the show Chucky Cruz. We're still going back on the name, but anyway, hey, shit is still, of course, crazy in Ferguson with essentially martial law being imposed there, right? But it does look at least like the Ice Bucket Challenge is coming to a close. I mean, either that or it's just run through the gamut of my friends on Facebook. Yeah, now I get a repost from people sending celebrity Ice Bucket Challenges. And, you know, it got me to thinking, I just might actually might put together a video montage of all the celebrity Ice Bucket Challenges that are going on now. It's just so inspirational watching, you know, like Oprah take the challenge. I really can't get enough of it. Ha! Oh, fuck. I know. But the Minecraft, it's for charity. Yeah. All right. I get it. Well, what? So now every time a charity organization wants to raise funds, this can only happen if we the sheeple perform a stupid act on video and post it for the entire world to see? Where's this going to end, huh? Where's it going to end? Nipple piercing for bulimia? About cliff diving for cleft palates? Maybe cat juggling for spina bifida? Really? I had the Steve Martin cat juggling thing queued up for audio and didn't play. You know, come on.
Good Lord. Anyway. I've heard about this cat juggling.
Father, could there be a God that would let this happen?
All right, we're still working that kinks up. The timing was off, but excellent question, Mr. Navin Johnson, and let's hope not. Hey, speaking of ugliness, we here in the front row heard that, this is actually kind of big news. We heard that Robin Williams didn't actually die by a suicide hanging. No, I guess we read on the internet where he actually did the Ice Bucket Challenge. He did the Ice Bucket Challenge after knocking back an 8-ball in one snort. And oddly enough, it wasn't a heart attack, but he went running back for another bump, tripped on the ice, and cracked his squash wide open. Jesus. Unfortunately, we don't know at this time who he passed the challenge on to, but, you know, we'll be sure to pass on any new info, verified or not, because that's how we roll here in the front row. Ah, come on now, don't give me that too soon shit. That's the way the man was himself, you know? Not giving a shit about offending people. And knocking back 8-balls in one whack, come on! Ah, shit. So hey, as usual, we got a jam-packed show for you tonight. Seriously, it is fuller than Robin Williams' nostrils in the 80s. I know you say 80s! Like 2 weeks ago! Ah, shit, but, so, hey, this is the front row at the Freak Show. Let me roll out. We are still looking. What is this, episode 5? All right, we are still looking for caller number 1. Who's it going to be? We know you're out there. We know you got a phone. So be it. Do it. Step on up. Call us here at the front row at the Freak Show. The number to do that is 646-668-8756. Don't be shy. It's 646-668-8756. And I don't know if I did this before last show or not, but anyway, hey, we are now tweeting. You can find us at the Freak Show. So the little at sign and then at the Freak Show. I know it. Front row was taken. Freak Show was taken. The front row, the Freak Show, all taken. So we had to go with at the Freak Show. And, of course, we are now pretty well up and running, too. We got our website / blog back, and that you can get right at frontrowatthefreakshow.com. And still a work in progress, obviously, all around, but you can get the archived versions of the podcast. We're still working on the first few episodes. I got one more. I got last week's to do. And then, you know, then we should have them up, and I'm hoping by, you know, Wednesday of each week to have those up on the website as well. And there's going to be a lot of other good shit here, a lot that have to do, actually, with what we're going to be talking about tonight. You know, waking up, watching the Watchers, and a guide to waking up. And that's really my vision for the website. Certainly, like, I got a video page where, you know, I see things that come up, you know, whatever they are, you know, be it news, be it comedy, be it tunes. You know, every once in a while I just throw up a random shorter type video, and I got a documentary page and a Good Freaks to Know page. So, again, like, a lot of the stuff that I'm going to be bringing up here later on the show tonight. So check it out. That, again, is frontrowatthefreakshow.com. And, you know, actually this week, a little ticked off on a couple of fronts. Well, on a lot of fronts, and we'll get to that later. But on one front, because, yeah, it was screwed up. My show last week, Waking Up Is Hard to Do, was not listed in my list of shows on blogtalkradio.com/frontrow. Right? And as it turns out, it's because I rated the show for, you know, mature audiences. You get public, PG-13, rated R. And, you know, hey, being the straight up guy I am, want to let people know that there's going to be some, you know, maybe, unsavory language. But, because of this, it wasn't listed in my list. So if you went to blogtalkradio.com/frontrow, you didn't see it listed there. It's ridiculous. And, you know, I went back and forth. And I've been really happy with Blog Talk Radio, giving them a little plug here. I just ultimately had to, you know, rate the show as public and whatever. But, you know, but they did answer my question right away, found out why. I think it's silly. But, you know, as far as support and all that stuff goes, they were right on it. So, cheers to them. All right, so, since we got a lot to do, like I said last week, we're going to try to really get going with the show with what we like to call, you know, I need a little, like, intro music for this or something, you know? The Front Row Scuttlebutt. And that's where we're going to cover some news from around the globe to around the corner. And that's how we'll be kicking out the show. So let's get right into it, okay? First up in the scuttlebutt, there was an Ohio morgue attendant that admitted to having sex with 100 corpses. I'm assuming that it was not all at once. He added that sometimes he was either drunk or on drugs while violating the corpses. Quote, I would just get on top of them and pull my pants down, end quote. Douglas, I guess his name was, I didn't actually include his name in, Douglas something. If I hadn't had anything to drink when I went to work, it wouldn't happen. So... basically, I guess it took a couple of cold ones for him to want another cold one. Oh, here's my question, though. Is this happening in other places of the world? You know, I mean, like a Russian or Chinese or Slovakian morgue attendants banging their clients? Is that happening other places? You know, I mean, because it kind of seems to happen somewhat frequently here. You know? And you know what else fascinates me? I am just extremely, I guess, just fascinated by, like, how the first one went down, right? I mean, that had to be Stiffy number one, because, again, you didn't do them all at once. When and how do you cross that Rubicon? You know?
Shit, I know she's cold, but she's so fucking hot!
I guess what's ultimately the saddest thing about this story? Not even really a blip on the news radar here in the freak show that is the United States of America. You know, call me old-fashioned, but I seem to remember a day when a guy getting it on with one dead chick would be a pretty big story. This guy, Don Juan's over 100 and crickets? You know, seriously, I went back to look up the story because I originally found the link on Drudge, on the Drudge Report. But anyway, I binged. Some of you like to Google. I binged Ohio mortician sex with corpses. And I got a bunch of really deeply disturbing hits, but ultimately only two pertaining to this story. And they were from The Daily Surge and News 24 Kenya. So, I don't know. Maybe if it was a white mortician on black corpses, we would have had a big story. But hey, you know, I did also find out that, and you'll be glad to hear this, he did wear a condom. Yep. However, it's not because he thought he would, like, get STDs or even get the dead chicks knocked up, but no. He was wanting to keep his dick warm. That's what I call wearing a glove. All right, moving on here. Enough of that. Here's another one from the America Wear Toast file. Apparently, a high schooler was recently arrested. Yes, arrested for writing a story about killing a dinosaur with a, lock your ears now, you sensitive freaks out there, a gun. Yes, a gun. He had a fictional writing assignment where he imagined using this blasphemous weapon to take out a neighbor's pet dinosaur. And this was simply too much for the teacher, who sent him to the office, who then suspended the young man for the week. Then the police got involved, and they arrested him for disorderly conduct. Because he, hold on now, he actually got upset that it went this far. Are you fucking kidding me? 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 Question. What do we all do when this type of story happens? All the time. Right? Like last year, a kid, a small one too, 6, 7, 8, was suspended because he had a Pop-Tart. He took a bite, and the subsequent shape of the bitten Pop-Tart kind of, sort of, in some really abstract, I guess so, if you looked at it the right way, looked like a gun. I'm serious. Basically, it was L-shaped on its side. And he got suspended for this. Or kids getting arrested for writing in chalk on the sidewalk. Or having their lemonade stand taken down because they don't have permits. What are we doing when we hear these stories? Right? We just say something to the effect of, are you fucking kidding me? And we move on, right? Oh, that's crazy. We don't do shit. Freaks, we got to start standing up to these smaller tyrannies. For lack of a better word, right? I mean, that's what it is. It's tyranny. If this shit happens in your town, you need to act. Speak the hell up. Say something. Do something. Bitch slap that teacher. All right, maybe don't bitch slap her, but make a quick little video and throw it up on YouTube. You know, say the teacher's, call the teacher's name out. Call the cop's name out. Interview the kid. Hey, you got time to take the ice bucket challenge, right? Maybe one of you freaks out there listening can develop like a freak show alert system app. You know, something freaky like one of these things goes down around you and it alerts others in your front row around you to assemble and spring into freak action. That kid has a lemonade stand taken down. Put it back up. Stand next to him. Refusing to let the police take it down again. Because this shit is happening. It's like every damn day. Lemonade stands getting taken down. Kids getting harassed for writing in chalk on the side. Playing with toy or water guns in their own yards. The gun thing is just out of control. It's out of control. I mean, say almost as scary with the kid in the story about the shooting the dinosaur. Like the kid imagined shooting a dinosaur. He's suspended and arrested. But almost as scary was his mother's reaction to her son getting arrested. Because she said, you know, I could see him making him rewrite it because he mentioned a gun. What? You can? Because he used a gun to kill a dinosaur in his imagined story? Jesus. Now, this, of course, is probably the same mom who lets the kid play 50 hours of Call of Duty 12 on Xbox every week. No. The teacher, first off, needs to be suspended or fired for being a douche. Literally, on the paperwork where it says reason for suspension, it should say douchiness above and beyond socially accepted levels. Then the cops that arrested him should be fined in the amount it takes to send this kid and a friend to someplace cool they want to go. Seriously. Oh, yeah, and don't forget, the front offices at the school should be punished for not only suspending him, but not calling the taller out, not calling the teacher out, for extreme douchiness. Douchebaggery. And then, of course, none of these people, the teachers, the front office, the cops, should be able to go anywhere in town without facing severe ridicule and verbal abuse from the township. That's my world. That's Craftyville right there. All right. Final tidbit here from the front row scuttlebutt. You see this? No, probably not. But just a little article. Well, maybe he did. It was on Drudge. Just a little article from the local CBS in Chicago, CBS.com Chicago. And here's the article. I'll just kind of read it a little bit. But over the past 6 years, Chicago has become a top potential target for international terrorists. A top security expert said Friday, making the posting of a veiled threat by Islamic radicals on Twitter a higher cause for concern. Quote, many terror organizations refer to Chicago as Obamatown, end quote, said CBS2 security expert Ross Rice, a former FBI agent in Chicago. Under President Obama, the United States took out Osama bin Laden and used repeated drone strikes to weaken terror networks. In the meantime, the U.S. government on Friday issued a security bulletin to all U.S. law enforcement in light of the overall threat posed by Islamic State, commonly known ISIL. The ominous post on Twitter, purportedly from somebody connected with Islamic State, shows a photo of the old Republic building, 307 North Michigan Ave, in Chicago, and the White House. The text reads, hashtag, a message from ISIS to U.S. We are in your state. We are in your cities. We are in your streets. You are our goals anywhere. And it wasn't very good Muslim. The handwritten note is dated June 20. This is still reading the article. The security bulletin issued Friday cautioned that there was no known threat to any U.S. cities. The Twitter message seems to imply that Islamic State operatives are in Chicago and other U.S. cities. Islamic State is responsible for executing kidnapped journalist James Foley. Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel said ISIS and, quote, imminent threat to every interest we have, end quote. Making things more complicated is the fact that these radicalized men are U.S. citizens or foreign nationals here legally, making it easy for them to travel and avoid suspicion. Islamic State released a horrific video this week showing the beheading Foley, who was a graduate of Northwestern University. Holy shit, where do we start on this one? All right. Well, first of all, problem is, I say that this was a little article from, you know, local Chicago CBS, but, you know, it was, as I said, on Drudge, and it was actually for a little period of time the main link, like the first headline link. So, you know what? I'm sure a lot of people did end up clicking on it, even if many of you haven't. All right, so, quote, many terror organizations, from the article? How many are there? Seriously, how many, you know, what did it say specifically? Many terror organizations refer to Chicago as Obamatown. How many terror organizations are there? I mean, since 9/11, how many terror organizations have you heard of besides Al-Qaeda? And, you know, now recently ISIS, right? Okay, I'm sure, like, you know, the KKK must be a terror organization, or like one of the Palestinian groups or something. Are probably labeled that way. Maybe even those fruitcakes up in Northern Ireland are technically terrorist organizations. But how many out there actually, like, looking to do harm here in America? And then my second question is, how many of them are actually using the phrase Obamatown? Because I'm guessing it's zero. I don't think anyone's ever called it Obamatown. But anyway, let's move on through the article. Under President Obama, the U.S. took out Osama bin Laden and used repeated drone strikes to weaken terror networks. Well, hold on here, because we're hearing and reading about all these new threats, and that Al-Qaeda and ISIS have surged the last few years. So my question is, how are these drone strikes actually weakening the terror networks? They seem more out of control than they ever were. I also looked into security expert Ross Rice. Yeah. All right. He was FBI for a long time, but he spent half of his 30-year career, the first half, on local Chicago shit, like the mob and bank robberies and stuff like that. And since 1999, he took over the media coordinator duties and started a Chicago's Most Wanted show, trying to catch local bank robbers and criminals. So exactly what kind of international terror expert is this? Seriously. So despite this being some sort of piece to show that somehow Chicago was a target, they feel they need to report a beheading in there twice? What has that got to do with anything? And lastly, it states, making things more complicated is the fact that these radicalized men are U.S. citizens or foreign nationals here illegally, making it easy for them to travel and avoid suspicion. The FBI, CIA, NSA records and tracks and follows every single phone call, email, text, website visit, and bathroom jack-off session of every American 24/7. And they're somehow handcuffed by this? Because they're citizens, it makes it more complicated? So you're telling me that with all the surveillance, the trillions spent, and the liberties lost, we can't even keep track of international terrorists? Has anyone seen Enemy of the State? Of course you have, right? You know, and I got to do a whole show on movies and how they fit into all this bullshit. But that movie was like 1999, right? So 15 years ago. And yes, I'm fully aware this was a fiction. However, there's certainly a whole lot of truth in, say, the capabilities of how an agency like the NSA can track, monitor, and in general, crawl up the ass of people, and especially the ones, for whatever reason, are lined up in their crosshairs. You know, of course, in the movie, it was because Will Smith unknowingly had evidence that the head of the NSA popped a senator and sent him for a nap with the fishes. I'm sure a fiction that they didn't have to stretch the imagination too far in coming up with. But regardless, nowhere on this planet are their ass-crawling abilities better than the United States of America. I mean, Jesus Christ, freaks. Are you buying any of this? I mean, they call Alex Jones a fearmonger? This is mongering at its finest. Look at how totally vague yet completely terrifying this is. You know, what is the point of this article except to scare you? There's no actual evidence. There's no nothing. And again, let's just slip in the beginning twice, which... this is kind of late-breaking news, and I haven't checked into it too much, so I don't want to go too far down the road, but I'm seeing reports today that it looks very well like this beheading was staged. Didn't happen. All right. Where are we? About a half hour in, huh? Okay. All right, so I need me some music. And before I lay down the tune, though, I do have to say this about YouTube. Because this is another thing that got me hopped up this week. Right? So basically when I'm done the podcast, I put it into MP3 or MP4 form so I can upload it to YouTube. And this week, I've had a couple of hiccups, but never as bad as this week when it's not allowed to be on YouTube. It got blocked because I used Bob Dylan's When You're Gonna Wake Up in it. So the whole 2 hours of my podcast is blocked. Because in that podcast, I use a Bob Dylan tune. You know, it's just ridiculous. I did file an appeal under the Fair Use Act. But, you know, seriously, I mean, YouTube, by its nature, is violating copyright all over the place, right? I mean, I did a video a few years ago for a Billy Joe Shaver tune, who I'm sure to be featuring on this show. I haven't yet, but we will get to Mr. Shaver. But anyway, I did a video for him. It's got like 200,000 hits now, right? Did pretty good. And I never monetized it. I never signed it up to get ads or anything like that. But YouTube puts ads on it. So you go and click on Billy Joe Shaver, Ragged Old Truck, and YouTube has their ads on it. You think Mr. Shaver is getting a check from YouTube for any of that stuff? Hell no. So it's just bullshit, you know? But anyway, so we're trying to figure that out. So that episode we haven't got on YouTube yet, so right now it's not on the website yet either. Anyway, I am going to go back to some outlaw country, but I'm going to really shake it up here as I'm going to roll out a little David Allan Coe for y'all. Yes, David Allan Coe. And I'm going to give you my thoughts on David afterwards. But for now, let's just hit it. And here's his tune, Spotlight.
I can't see nothing but spotlight. Spotlight see nothing but me. All of my music is lonely. All of my heartaches were free. Don't waste your time or your flash balls. Too many heroes are dead. You like to live in the city. Yeah, I like to live in my head. Somebody shoot out that spotlight. Spotlights ain't nothing but jive. Roll me a smoke. Give me some coke.
Tell all the girls that I'm single. Tell Lone Star Beer that I'm dry. Everybody's lying about living. Everyone's living a lie. Ain't that right, Mr. Mojo Rising? Ah, David Allan Coe, I tell ya. Alright, you know, I actually, I end up having to say this. A lot about David. And that is, I actually don't like the guy. You know, I'm not a personal fan of David Allan Coe. I think he's a douche, to be quite honest with you. I really do. However, he makes me listen to him, you know? His shit is just that good. And he's perhaps the most underrated songwriter of all time. And his voice, oh, man, forget about it. Shit, just awesome. And, yeah, it really just sucks that all that talent went to a complete douchebag. It did. Hey, this is the Front Row at the Freak Show. I am your host, Crafty. Callers, still looking for you. 646-668-8756. 646-668-8756. We need that to be like, you know, 800 front row or something. That works, doesn't it? 800 front row. Don't call that, but that's what we need it to be. And again, you can find us at the Freak Show on Twitter. And the website is frontrowatthefreakshow.com. But anyway, so, you know, I chose David Allan Coe kind of for a reason. And to be perfectly honest, it was just, you know, David gets me fired up, all right? And so he really, the mood I've been in these last few days, this last week, since the last show, well, let me just say, I'm bullshit. All right, I am bullshit, I am fed up, I am tired, and, well, let me just say this, let me just put it out there, okay? We're going to throw it out there. I want a revolution. Yes, I want a revolution, and I want it to start tomorrow. Seriously. I don't care if it takes total economic collapse to get it, fine. Peaceful, violent, whatever. Of course, I'd rather it peaceful because I don't have any weapons. Unless, of course, you know where I live. And then, yeah, of course I'm packing. But no, what? Just bring it already because, again, I'm just fed up with all the bullshit. I really am. You know, I've obviously devoted a fair share of time on this podcast to covering the state of the Freak Show out there, from all the stats in week one to 9/11 and the Fed. And that shit right there, that shit right there was enough to know for me that this ship don't need turning. It needs capsizing. I mean, it needs, like, you know, King Kong to come along and pick the fucking thing up and shake the piss out of it. You know, as a side, I actually, speaking of ships and capsizing, I watched Noah the other night. Now, that's what I'm talking about, babe. We need some biblical flooding around up in here. Check this out. When I watched Noah, right, I was clicking around for something to watch, and I have Netflix, and I was clicking through the documentaries page, and I shit you not, it just whacked me in the face with the amount of shit, bullshit, of course, that lots and lots of people are spending lots and lots of time and lots of money trying to tell us. It's amazing. Just by, you could run a documentary on all the documentaries. You got your food documentary, dozens of them. And on different aspects, too. Some about the obesity problem or the starvation problem or the poison they're putting in our crops, or the poison they're injecting right into the animals that we chomp. You got your water documentaries. Again, some people not having enough, or in the case of the corporations, having it all and privatizing it. Or also, again, the ones about poisons in and being added to our water supply. You, of course, have your war documentaries and all the different ugliness of all the different wars that we continue to seek out, and the millions, no, billions of lives that have been forever ruined as a result, and that most of them have been completely avoidable, or the nice little side topic of wars, of course, right? Torture. You can't go down the list with almost every second, third, or fourth one being about the environment and all the different damages there. It's endless.
You got your drug documentaries, your extreme violence documentaries, your civil rights ones, your child pedophilia and sex trafficking ones. How about the health documentaries? Holy shit. That it's increasing, that it's getting worse. We cured this, but 9 new things took its place. Education. Yeah, I think you can find one or two on this subject. Pissed off teachers, pissed off students, pissed off parents. Everybody's pissed. Except the people running the freaking programs because their salary is doubling every fucking year. All this, freaks, all this. And I haven't even mentioned political or economic documentaries. Where do you want to start there? Holy good God! Speaking of which, I then, of course, come to the one that tells me how God is sitting up in the sky watching all this and how much he fucking loves me. Alright, I'm going to spare you my God rant right now, but rest assured, my fellow freaks, that is coming to a front row near you. So I've said it before and I'll say it again right now. Conspiracy? Maybe. Screwed? No. Most abso-freaking-lutely. Actually, I got a little bonus treat for you right now. Check this out. I'm going to still play some stand-up comedy for you. Yes. Yes, I got the musings of Bill Burr coming up. But since I was speaking about documentaries, earlier in the week, I listened/watched a lot of the documentaries I don't watch, you know, I just listen to, I'll put them on in my car or something like that. But anyway, I went and rewatched this one called Own and Operate It. Really a good documentary, and you should definitely check it out. But I don't know if I specifically picked up on this part before because I wasn't aware of the guy, and now I am, but it's got this segment in it, in this rant from a guy called Lee Camp. And he's pretty goddamn funny in his own right. Let me just play the clip, and then we'll pick it up after that. So here it is from Owned and Operated, Lee Camp.
Our financial market actively rewards being a giant cunt, like a radioactive Ann Coulter who's grown to Godzilla proportions. Does that not freak anyone out?
Pfizer sales reps promoted it illegally for surgical pain in higher doses, uses the FDA had rejected due to safety concerns. Doctors responded. Instead of prescribing, say, ibuprofen at pennies a pill, they prescribed Bextra at nearly $3 a pill.
Sales were very good.
You might have heard of the Yes Men. They do social activism pranks on corporations. For example, last week they announced that General Electric, which uses loopholes to avoid taxes, was going to give back the $3.2 billion in refunds it got from the government. For another time, they told the media that Dow Chemical would finally be paying the victims of a massive chemical spill millions of dollars in restitution. For another time, they announced that director Michael Bay would be giving us all 2 hours of our lives back. So after these hoaxes, the corporations have to come out and go, oh, actually, that good thing you heard about, yeah, we're totally not doing that. No, not at all. Now here's the interesting part. During the half hour when everyone thinks the hoax is true, the company's stock tumbles like crazy. GE lost billions. Dow lost billions. This means we've created a system where companies get massively punished for doing good things for humanity. So if a corporation announces it will constantly take over a 50-year-old locally owned company and fire all the employees, is given the financial equivalent of a high five and a reach around. If, on the other hand, it announces it will give free AIDS medication to the dying people of Ghana, then Wall Street knocks it unconscious and draws the word queer on its forehead.
In this grainy seminar video posted on the file sharing site YouTube, a Pittsburgh law firm on how to use loopholes to ensure foreign workers can get the jobs instead of Americans.
And our goal is clearly not to find a qualified and interested U.S. worker. Here's the thing. If Wall Street weren't around yet, would you create it to be this way? Would you say, let's make a financial system wherein companies are rewarded for being piping hot douche holes, and if one of them does something good for humanity, we'll treat that with suspicion. You announced you're going to pay the victims of a horrific oil spill? What are you, Sean Penn? You're a multinational. You can't go around caring about people. Could you imagine if every company did that? The whole system would break down. People would have food and clean water. There'd be fewer wars, death, and hardship. What kind of world would that be? Not one I want my trust fund babies to grow up in.
No, yeah, Lee is good, man. To be honest, I'm just getting more into him now. He does a segment on RT, Russia TV. And, you know, if you want some good reporting, yeah, go figure. You got to go to Russia to get it. No, I mean, it's actually like an American branch, but it's still called RT. So you can check them out. But his segment on that is called Redacted. Just YouTube him. You know, you'll find his stuff. And, again, his name is Lee Camp. I'm not exactly sure how much of the, of that whole segment. I think the documentary inserted some stuff within it. But, you know, it does make for a pretty good, funny, and sobering expose, to say the least. But, all right, so anyway, before you go jumping off a bridge from all this stuff, or before you go, you know, cranking down an eight ball while doing the ice bucket challenge, we know how dangerous that can be. But before you go doing that, let me just say this. All that shit here that I just mentioned, you know, all those documentaries on all the different subjects. You know, again, like all the stuff that I've been talking about. It's basically because of one fucking thing, just one. And that's why I have hope. Yeah, no doubt, it's a biggie. But it's just one thing. The big fucking club. And, you know, to quote Major Frank Burns from MASH here, never before have so many suffered so much so few can be so happy. It's one of my favorites, but he fucking nailed it. And that's it, we take down those bitches. We take them down and it's cake and eat it two time, my friends. We've got to wake the fuck up here. I really do feel like it is happening, but I just don't know if it's happening fast enough. That's why it's so important for you freaks that are awake and waking up to share and spread your knowledge with everyone you know. Oh, no, don't you. Come on, Crafty. People don't want to talk about this stuff. Fuck 'em! You lose some friends or family members over it? Again, fuck 'em! There's really, like, two ways people respond, okay? The first is, they don't believe you. And, hey, I guess it all depends on what they don't believe, but, you know, like, everything I've talked about here so far, in the front row, all the net stats and numbers I've thrown out, all documented, all backed up. And, yes, I want to throw out my own disclosure. Once again, I seem like I got to do this every week, but until it happens, you know, again, we are working on that aspect of our podcast and our website of getting everything documented and referenced so you can easily find it. But that shit is out there. You know? So, I mean, there's books. Again, obviously documentaries, websites. And the other argument you'll hear is, why are you going to be so negative all the time, you know? I don't want to think about this stuff. I want to be happy. Well, shit, fuck. You know what? I want to be happy too, but let me ask you something. If there's a tornado headed to your house, would you rather I tell you that little piece of negative information or not tell you so you can happily get your house smashed on top of you? Folks, we gotta remember, keep the eye on the prize. I'm of the opinion that we knock these bastards out. Ho-ho! Let the party begin. Seriously. How happy you think you can be with, say, keeping a shitload more money? Or making a ton more in less time? How about shit like free energy? Or how about a time when medical cures aren't suppressed? How about just when you put away money? It's actually, like, worth the same amount, if not more, in 10 or 20 or 30 years? And not actually, like, half of what you put in? And on down the line. Huh? I've already mentioned there many times in the front row about turning off the Mockingbird mainstream media. And again, I get Mockingbird from Operation Mockingbird, known, documented CIA influence on the media, on Hollywood. But where do you go to get good, reliable news and info? Well, the internet, of course, right? Well, the library, too, naturally, but you do have to know what to look for before heading in. So, you know, let's start online, shall we? I think it goes without saying that with as many good people there are out there, as many good, you know, different news sites, whether it's a blog, a full-blown website, or our YouTube channel, but with as many good ones as there are, there's 10 times that amount in Shinola. I'm hopefully not telling you something you don't already know, that not everything you read on the internet is true. If you listen to how some of the mainstream media guys tell it, there's no way anything on the internet could be legitimate. Obviously, right? That shit threatens them. They can't have that. But anyway, I did get started on this last week a little, and I do remember getting a little rushed for time there at the end, but, you know, I did have time. I brought up Alex Jones and all the work he's done, him and his reporters at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.tv, and I also spoke a little bit about Drudge and the DrudgeReport.com. And, you know, obviously, whether we're doing Scuttlebutt or other things here, I'm sure we'll be mentioning both of these guys and a lot. And going to their stories in there. That's actually on InfoWars right now, is where they are putting out there about the reporter beheading being staged. And again, I just saw it today, and I haven't had time to follow their links and everything else like that, but I am at a certain level of confidence with InfoWars that, you know, they're a pretty big and legit operation. And are they right 100% of the time? No, but Alex doesn't also usually just throw shit against the wall, you know? Not for something like that, you know? Anyway. So, you know, take it for what it's worth right now. But, you know, I'm sure we'll be looking at it over the next few days. But anyway, hey, in my opinion, these are both two stops. You know, InfoWars and Drudge Report. Two stops you should be making daily for your news. Among others, but what's great about this shit, too, is, you know, it does take a little bit more time than, obviously, just clicking on your TV and putting it on Fox, but only at first, all right? Once you got yourself set up, I mean, certainly with, like, Drudge and Alex and a lot of these guys, they got their own apps on for your smartphones and shit, and, you know, once you start getting into different YouTube channels and all that stuff that you like and you trust, well, you subscribe to those channels, and bam, you got those at your fingertips. And then, obviously, just use your bookmarks on your web browser. You know, make a news folder and start adding to it. And before you know it, easy peasy, Japanesey. I also mentioned last week, I brought up the three guys, the Alex Jones, Stefan Molyneux, and Peter Joseph. And I was thinking about it and going back and forth, and I actually think I'm going to run early this week. I'll, you know, probably end at, you know, in a half an hour or so. But I'm going to defer these guys again for another kind of full-blown conversation another time. You know, because I think it needs its own kind of segment. And certainly, you know, I don't... Adding Molyneux, it's a tough call. Whether he's at the level of Peter Joseph with Zeitgeist or Alex with InfoWars and stuff like that, I don't know. I got to look at where he is, volume, you know, number of hits and all this stuff. Again, kind of self-proclaimed number one, most viewed, most watched, most listened to philosophy show in the world. And that's according to him. And, you know, but, you know, he is a bit of a pompous guy, ass sometimes. But, you know, hey, just like David Allan Coe, you know, I don't necessarily need to like a guy personally to get value from him. You know, and I'm not, even with Molyneux, you know, I am not a regular, I don't tune in to Stefan Molyneux every day. He's not really that, like, he does cover current events and things of that sort, but he's not really like a news thing, nor is Zeitgeist. Zeitgeist is, you know, a way of life. But the interesting thing, how they, all these three guys interconnect, I mean, suffice it to say, you know, both Molyneux and Peter Joseph have been on the Alex Jones show. And, you know, there's a lot of similarities between them, but also a lot of differences. And actually, just before I forget, something you definitely want to check out. There is a debate between Peter Joseph and Stefan Molyneux. I think basically Peter Joseph came on Stefan Molyneux's show. And wow, just really good YouTube right there. I mean, also, I think that each succeeded in kind of knocking the other off his A game. But really interesting shit, okay? And, you know, the Zeitgeist thing, like I said, that's, it's more of a way of life or whatever. I mean, because, you know, what they did, and look, I'll get a couple of seconds here. I didn't really plan on this, but a couple of seconds on Zeitgeist. Just like Jones and Molyneux, okay, they come out, especially with the movies, and point out, you know, the big club, among other things, and all the different ways the current construct is absolutely broken to shit, right? And the Zeitgeist, I mean, the story is amazing. I mean, the guy kind of did the first one. There's three of them. There's three Zeitgeist movies, okay? And now there's an official Zeitgeist movement. But the first movie, according to his Peter Joseph, he actually kind of wrote it as a Broadway piece, but he put it together as a video, slapped it up on YouTube, and literally almost overnight, viral, you know, millions and millions and millions, hundreds of millions of views by this point. I think actually it got, like, taken down after a couple of years. So, like, the clock got reset. So, like, if you look at it now, it's you know, whatever crazy number it's at. But you got to, like, double it because maybe even triple it. You know, I think it was watched more in the first couple of years than it has been in the last couple of years. I don't know. But anyway, again, all about breaking down the current construct, our current system, you know, the current economic system, you know, an expanded version of what Lee Camp was ranting about, and just the complete unsustainability of what we have right now. And, you know, and then, okay, so, you know, you got Alex and Stefan who are doing this, you know, kind of more on a daily basis, while Zeitgeist has put out a thing, and they do have, it's weird, the movement, you know, is really, it's a self kind of growing thing, and people, there's a lot of people attached to the movement, but doing their own things. But at the end of the day, their solution is much different than Alex's or certainly Stefan Molyneux's. I mean, Stefan and Alex are really libertarians and, you know, believers in the free market. And Zeitgeist goes in a different direction. I'm going to leave it at that because when I get more into it, then I'm going to be running out of time. And I got to get to what I really do want to get to here. And that's bringing up some of the different players and sites and YouTube channels that can help you wake up. And, you know, this the list that I'm going to give you, I mean, you know, this has taken me, you know, it's the culmination of my 5-6 years of being awake. And remember, like I said, being awake, it's a process, you know. Yeah, there's usually a watershed moment that you know, knocks you on your ass and opens up your eyes, but, you know, it is a rabbit hole, so, you know, you just keep on going down it, and, you know, how far do you allow yourself down it? I mean, because that's just like the waking up process itself. You got to allow yourself to do it. You got to allow yourself to be the minority, because that's what we are right now. Anyway, let me get on with that shit. So I did want to just reiterate here from last week about Alex Jones. All right. He is crazy. All right. He is crazy. Hold on. I got a clip of Alex. Hold on.
The guns, the iron rods, Pierce didn't do it. The tyrants did it. Hitler took the guns. Stalin took the guns. Mao took the guns. Fidel Castro took the guns. Hugo Chavez took the guns. And I'm here to tell you, 1776 will commence again if you try to take our firearms. Doesn't matter how many lemmings you get out there on the street begging for them to have their guns taken. We will not relinquish them. Do you understand? That's why you're going to fail, and the establishment knows, no matter how much propaganda, the Republic will rise again when you attempt to take our guns.
How many lemmings you roll out. That was Alex on the Pierce Morgan show, which thankfully has been canceled. But that was actually just a couple of months after Sandy Hook. And, but anyway, you know, I mean, that's, you know, a small sample of him on his show. So no doubt about it, the man is crazy. But for me, it's just the type of crazy we need, you know. I do think he, you know, there's a great debate in this, you know, the Alex Jones circles after that show. But, you know, that interview that he was on live for was about 15 minutes. And, I mean, he went nuts. I mean, he went absolutely nuts. And there was this great debate afterwards. You know, was it a good thing? Was it a bad thing? I always thought that ultimately it did more harm than good. It was him exposing himself to mainstream media and a new viewership. And I just don't think yelling and going crazy and antagonizing, which is what he did, you know, is the way to win those people. Now, a lot of people said, well, he woke the zombies up, you know, he gave them something different. And I guess there's an element of that. I don't know. But, whatever, you know. But he takes time to get used to. You know, you can't just listen to a show or just a YouTube clip or a couple. You have to give him some time, you know? I mean, he's got so many sides to him. And what I've always said, that to me the best part about Alex Jones and the Alex Jones show and the nightly news that his other reporters do, not so much there, but, yeah, I mean, they get him there. But the Alex Jones show, he just gets the most amazing, incredible guests on there. And, I mean, you're talking about maybe 10 a week, you know, and not like these Fox shows or MSNBC shows that have a guy on and it's for a minute, you know. He has guests on for a half an hour sometimes. Really picking their brains and getting way beyond just the trivial bullshit, you know. But amazing, amazing guests. And it's always been, you know, more than anything, I agree with him and some of his positions is just the guests that he has on and the exposure that they bring to, you know, all sorts of different subjects. Because, you know, all these guys are usually high up, ex-military, or, you know, the written books, and just, I could go on and on and on about his guests, but, you know, anyway, it's like anyone, it's like the guys I'm going to list off here, or start getting into, you know, you can't follow anyone blindly, you know, just period, you know, whether it's Alex Jones, the Republicans, or the Democrats. You know, to just say you follow this guy and take everything that he, she, or whoever says verbatim, you know, that's not the way to go about it. I mean, nothing pisses me off more than these, I'm a Republican, I just vote Republican right on the fucking line, blah, 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 blah. Holy shit. All right, so I am going to get into the official list of people, but let's have a little comedy right now, okay? So this week, I just got Bill Burr on the brain, and so that's what we're going to play. It is Bill Burr here in the front row at the Freak Show.
I want to get a gun. I do. I really do. I never had that feeling before till I moved out to Los Angeles. The city just messes with your mind, you know? It's overpopulated, technically doesn't have a water supply, right? The dollar's crashing. Shit keeps you up at night, you're just sick of it. What am I going to do when the zombies come? Right? Start reading up on shit, get some powdered food, plant some zucchini, get a windmill, right? And that's all well and good, but if you don't know how to fight, all you're doing is gathering supplies for the toughest guy in the block. Right? Thinking about that, what am I going to do? Some dude turns me upside down, starts shaking the gold coins out of my pocket. I got to get a gun. So I'm on the road, right? I'm in Reno. Great gun town. So I go down to their little gun store, right? Come walking in, there's some redneck there. I'm like, hey, man, I want to get a gun. He's like, I hear you. What you looking for? What you want? Mossberg, over under, 357 Magnum, right? Starts rattling off all this gibberish, right? I don't know shit. I'm trying to play it off. I feel like a bitch because I don't know anything about guns. So I was like, what do I do here? Ah, hell, well, I go, I'm going to go with honesty. I go, look, dude, I don't know anything about guns. They terrify me, but I'm worried about the zombies. All right? Dude's just like, you need a shotgun. Need a shotgun, man. It's got a good spread. It's easy to load. Doesn't have a lot of working parts. It's got a good spread. He kept saying that. It's got a good spread. I'm like, what does that mean? He goes, well, it means you ain't got to be that accurate. It's got a good spread. Further away you are, the more shit you hit. It's got a good spread. In fact, you got a problem over here. You ain't got to look. You just turn. Wow, that's it. You ain't got a problem over here anymore. Anything that was even remotely a problem ain't there anymore, trust me. And then these people here, they saw what you just did here. You ain't got a problem here either. Feel me? 90 degrees taken care of right there. One shot. These people get smart, flip it over. Wow! That's it. Got a good spread. So I'm like laughing my ass off. I'm like, dude, look, I just want to shoot the guy. I don't have to do a bunch of drywall work, you know? Reframe my diploma. Get my parakeet another friend, you know? I just want to shoot the guy. So I'm like, you know, how about one of these pistols? So he does like that classic, like that redneck trailing off thing, like, ah, you want a pistol? I get a pistol. What do I know? I've just been here 20 years. You know? Get a shiny one, huh? So I was like, dude, what's wrong with getting a pistol? He goes, I'll tell you what, buddy. Because life ain't a movie. You feel me? I'm like, no. Can you please stop speaking in these backwards riddles? Can you just say what you're saying? I told you I don't know shit about guns. Come on, do me a solid here. He goes, well, look, you ever watch a movie? Guy goes, blah, blah, blah. He kills three people. Real life, man, you miss. You miss all the fucking time. You miss enough times, man, you're empty. Might as well just be standing there with a big stapler in your hand. Man, what you gonna do? I was like, well, fuck it. Let's get the shotgun. He's all ready to box the thing up, and then I'm like, wait a minute. I live with my girl. I can't just show up with a shotgun. Right? That's not some shit you can just come home with. If I found this stool on the side of the road, I can come home with this. Look at it. We can refinish it. We can carve our initials in it. We can have a good time, right? You just show up with a shotgun. Hey, I got it for us, right? One barrel for you, one for me. No. So she kiboshes the whole thing. Till the other night, somebody broke into our car sitting in the driveway. Starts fucking with her head, right? So she starts reading up on guns, you know? She's reading too much, because now she wants to get one, but she's just like, well, I heard you got to keep the bullets in the safe, keep the stock in the garage. And then what? Then what? I run around the house and assemble it with some dudes chasing me with an axe? You know, even thinking this thing through, sweetheart. Run around. Where's the scope? It's in the living room. He's in the living room! No, we're getting this thing. I want that fucking thing loaded right on the bedroom wall. Right there. I'll put that thing on my jam sleeve. Just like that. No other point. That's funny, though, when you talk about getting a gun. You know? People, like, they either totally for it or completely against it. You know, they either go nuts and start screaming, right? Or they start throwing out those stats. Yeah, actually, you increase your chances of getting shot by 80% the second you get a gun in the house. Really? What, because I'm going to load it and shower with it? Like, the fuck? I know it's dangerous. You get a pool in your backyard, you immediately increase your odds of drowning in your backyard, right? You couldn't do that before. Now you step on a rake, in you go. No, I'm telling you. I don't buy into any of that shit.
Yeah, yes. Mr. Billy Burr. Hope you enjoyed that. I'm pretty sure that... I haven't looked too much into his, like, personal thing. I'm pretty sure Billy is local to my area, Boston scene. So anyway, I thought that was a pretty appropriate few minutes from Mr. Burr. I am Steve Crafts. This is Front Row at the Freak Show. And as we've been saying, please follow us on Twitter at the Freak Show and frontrowatthefreakshow.com. And you got, 20 minutes, 30 minutes left if you want to be number one. 646-668-8756. That's 646-668-8756. All right, so, as promised, let's get into some of the players out there, and mostly going to kind of list them off. And again, just so you know, we have it started. Good Freaks to Know. I think... I only got three of them on there right now. I just got caught up in the design shit on the website and everything else like that. But there are video clips and all that from these guys on frontrowatthefreakshow.com. But that is going to be it's priority number one is building that page, the Good Freaks to Know page, on the website. So you will soon be able to find links to their websites, all that shit, right there. But no particular order here either. I just, you know, kind of went through my YouTube channels and was writing down names as they came up with me. But again, you know, none of these guys here, like all these guys that, you know, I've kind of checked out, and when they provide links, I follow the links and I do the, I'm checking up on them. So, you know, it's been, again, accumulated over a few years, and, you know, most of these guys, I think, have a YouTube channel. No, that's not true. Well, a good percentage of them do, I guess. But it's great. You just subscribe to them, and then you can put the option on if you want, you know, to get an email every time these guys post something, you know, and then just write in your emails the link to the new thing that they post, and ba-boom, you know, you're following. So, anyway, and most of them have Facebook pages that, you know, you can also get the notifications from that way, or Twitter. So all sorts of different ways, obviously, to stay tuned and stay on top. And again, more than anything, what I think all these guys are doing is reporting the truth, man. You know, it's how journalism should be. And it's what, you know, unfortunately, a lot of these guys aren't, you know, they're not allowed in, you know, in the seats in the White House press room. Not yet, anyway. But you stick just one of these guys in there. Oh, you know, this is, to me, these are the guys of that, you know, what journalism used to be. And not afraid to ask the tough questions and stay on the tough questions. You know, I'll just mention him first. We Are Change. The original is done by, there's a couple of guys that have done offshoots, like there's We Are Change London and We Are Change San Francisco. The original was started by a young man named Luke Radowski. And Luke just kicks ass, man. So he started We Are Change. Check out their YouTube channel. But he really started around 9/11. He's from New York. He was down very close to Ground Zero when it hit. He had a lot of friends that he lost on 9/11. And I'm not sure if any direct family, but I know he had a lot of close people that he lost on 9/11. And I mean, he's been in the, on the 9/11 truth movement as far as I can remember, and doing just some amazing work. And what Luke does, I mean, when you talk about old school journalism, I mean, this guy somehow, right, worms his way into just incredible places, you know, seminars where, you know, someone's given a speech or something like that, and he just gets in their grill and fires away questions, you know, or like a book signing. He'll, you know, get in, he'll, like, he's got spy cameras and stuff like that. It's amazing, you know. I mean, he's cornered like Henry Kissinger, the big new Brzezinski, just, you know, total complete globalist elite scumbags that they both are. Clinton, I mean, he's been on them all. And so, you know, he does occasionally branch out, do some other things, put some videos together, certainly highlights it when, you know, there's someone else, you know, doing something good. But Luke Radowski, I don't even know if he's 25 yet, you know. Maybe he is 25 to 30 or something like that in there. But just a really good, funny, talented kid. So that's We Are Change. Next up, David Icke. Oh, David. Yeah, you got to check out David. Now, he is a whole other level of waking up. David is Wow. Now that I've brought up his name, I don't even know where to start with the guy. But anyway, Ike started bringing this shit out a long, like 20, 25, 30 years ago. He was like a pro soccer player, right? Big time in England. And then a newscaster. And like through it all, like he had this vision or something like that, crazy. But anyway, and ever since then, he has been spreading the truth. And like I said, now this guy, he sold out, for instance, I think it was this year, spring of this year, Wembley Stadium. All right, Wembley Stadium. And he spoke for like 6 hours. It's like a six-hour show. And millions more of people tuning in on the webcast. I've watched bits of it and everything else, but he's got a lot of books out there. He's got his own. I always thought his website kind of lacked, to be honest with you. So I really more keep up with David. He's a guest on Alex Jones a lot, and but anyway, there's usually a lot of shorter clips of specific things that he's talking about on YouTube, and. But I must warn you, David does get into this, like the forces, the big club, right? The big club people are actually reptilians, or some of them are reptilians. Like he's got this real sense of, you know, the big club are truly evil demons people in that. They have suppressed us from a higher energy level, so all sorts of stuff like that. And you know, I mean, there's a, yeah, I know it's crazy, but I mean, in it all and through it all, he does do a lot of good reporting. I mean, and like he was on the mad pedophilia ring that exists in the English royalty and the English family. I mean, he's been on that for years and years. And then, you know, last year that freak show, Jimmy Savile, this British actor nut job. It came out after he died that he was a massive pedophile and super close ties to the royal family. It's just, you know, of course, nothing's ever officially broke about them, but it's only a matter of time. And there's actually stuff really cracking over there. And it's funny because that's when you really start to get into, like, you know, when he starts talking about these guys being reptilian, like actual reptilians. I mean, it's not metaphorical or anything. I mean, he's saying they are reptilians covered in a human skin. But again, when you go down that rabbit hole on how far you want to go, and it's not just him. There's reports cracking and surfacing and coming up all over the place about the massive pedophile sex trafficking ring that exists, not just in the English family, but all through the elites all around the world. It's like a rite of passage, almost, that you got to have sex with little kids to be a true member of the club. Sick. So, anyway, Ben Swan. Like Ben. Ben is a like super clean cut, like kind of in reporting ways, a lot the exact opposite of Alex Jones. doesn't have this show and all that stuff of Alex. He's not there yet. But he was actually mainstream on Fox, and he just had like a segment, a daily or weekly segment on Fox. Kind of got really popular, but he was asking some questions that, quite frankly, Fox doesn't like to ask or have answered. So he flipped him off and started his own thing. And, you know, BenSwan.com, Ben Swan on YouTube. And, again, I mean, you can just tell when, you know, this guy is a true reporter in every sense of the word. And real integrity. Again, everything researched, linked, referenced to all the stuff he says. So I highly recommend tuning into Ben Swan. G. Edward Griffin, we mentioned him when we did our 9/11 and the Fed show. He wrote the book, The Creature on Jekyll Island. He's written many other books. He has a website, therealnews.com. Let me check that real quick. I want to make sure that I have that. No, I'm sorry. Reality Zone is what it is. I knew I had it wrong, but Reality Zone is the name of his website. He comes out with unfiltered news. It's once a week, so sometimes it's not always the most current stuff, but you know, lots of good links. And again, just another resource to kind of go to. He's got some different stuff on there. It looks like the website is like from, you know, 98. But, so that's not his strong suit. But certainly the info that he's providing is. Richard Grove, who I also mentioned during the 9/11 podcast, 9/11 and the Fed, two big elephants, one room. I don't know if I did a good enough job emphasizing the importance of Richard Grove as a whistleblower for 9/11 and just in general on the connections between Wall Street and our government and certainly the CIA and the alphabet agencies. And his website is tragedyandhope.com, named after a book by Carol Quigley, which is a 1,300-page blueprint, really, for the Big Club. Carol Quigley was a member of the Big Club, and he reported on the Big Club, and it's a lot of the information about the Big Club is directly in that book. I have not read it all cover to cover, I will be honest. I have perused it. I have, you know, I have it. I don't have the book, but, you know, online, the e-book. Anyway, Richard Grove, and I mean, he is so cool, man. Does a lot of podcasts, and he is just all about learning. Just all about learning, ways to learn, again, with very interesting guests. And one thing is kind of a side shoot to Richard Grove and tragedyandhope.com. He's actually got, he interviewed this guy, John Taylor Gatto. And you can go to YouTube and look up The Ultimate History Lesson with John Taylor Gatto. And I think it's 6 hours or 8 hours. You know, and I just watched half an hour at a time, whatever. It is the most mind-blowing stuff that you can imagine. And John Taylor Gatto was this award-winning teacher in New York and, you know, completely turned kids' lives around, all sorts of awards and everything until, you know, they realized that what he was doing was actually teaching these kids critical thinking. And they put the kibosh on them. They shut them down. Well, anyway, you got to get his story. He goes through and he tells you exactly how our education system and the crock of shit that it is. I mean, and this guy can just reel off book after book, and he can tell you what page this quote is on. I mean, just one of those freaks, you know. But unbelievable. I mean, I want to call it a documentary, but just interview. Like, Richard Grove went to his house for a weekend, you know, and they shot, I don't know, you know, 2, 3, 4 hours a day, and then edited it and put it all together for this 6, 8 hour documentary, whatever it is, or, you know, again, interview. And it's just amazing. It's absolutely amazing. Watch it a few times. And, I mean, it just leads you into places and learning that you never been before. Greg Hunter. USAWatchdog.com. Basically a video blog, kind of like I'm doing here, but it's he stands up kind of live in front of the screen, and two, three a week he does. And again, what I love about him is they're short and sweet, about 15 minutes, half an hour long sometimes, but it's just guests. It's all guests. I think on Friday he does his own 15-minute like weekly recap, but just great guests talking about a lot about the economy, and but certainly with current events, but usually how they relate to the economy, and just talks a lot about exposing the Federal Reserve and the quantitative easing and the fiat money and the printing of money that cycles that we're in right now. So Greg Hunter, USAWatchdog.com. One of his guests very frequently is a guy called Paul Craig Roberts. And Dr. Paul Craig Roberts, this guy's everywhere. I mean, he was the former assistant treasury under Reagan. A lot of people call him the father of Reaganomics. He was the head editor. I forget exactly. Well, he was editor at the Washington Times. But, I mean, this guy is just a fountain of information. And, you know, is just fed up, obviously, with the direction this company, this country has taken since the days of Reagan. Now, you know, you can get into saying that, yeah, Reagan was, you know, no less a puppet than Obama. And that's certainly true, but I don't actually hear him talking about the old days too much. He's pretty much focused on the here and now. But, I mean, he's putting out articles every other week, every other day, and a very desired guest by Alex Jones, by Ben Swan, by Greg Hunter. So Dr. Paul Craig Roberts. Ron Paul. Jesus, Ron is, I think, busier now than he ever was when he was in Congress. But, I mean, Ron's got his own TV, Ron Paul TV. I don't know, it's $10 a month. I haven't done it yet. I mean, with all the stupid shit I buy, I should probably suck it up and buy Ron Paul TV. But I could obviously spend an hour talking about Ron Paul, his stance. You know, again, it kind of breaks that line of the solutions phase. You know, so once the shit hits the fan here, what do we do? Or, you know, if it's preventable, which most people I think are in agreement. But, you know, Ron still has some politician left in him. He doesn't go sometimes as far as I would like, but good Lord, the man just talks sense. Just talks sense, flat out. Not as sold on Rand as I am on Ron. But story for another day, I guess. Kind of can't mention Ron Paul without mentioning Lou Rockwell. Lou worked with Ron. I think he was on his when Ron was running for president. He was, you know, on his campaign staff somehow. But Lou, go to lourockwell.com. And great site. He has an app as well. And all it is a collection of essays and articles from other guys, like Dr. Paul Craig Roberts will be on there, for example. It's nice, too, because it's not always all economy or war. Just, you know, he does get writers and submissions on other stuff, like the 10 best ways to, you know, take care of your car, you know, stuff like that, you know, sometimes like prepper articles. And but it's really what it is, just a list. Here's, like, I think he lists 10, and one or two a day are getting recycled and put on there. But huge libertarian, huge believer in You know, well, I should say, he knocks down the Keynesian economic system that most of our guys, you know, the people who are pulling our strings, subscribe to. So, anyway, again, Lou Rockwell. James Corbett, another guy I brought up in the 9/11 episode, CorbettReport.com. And I think I said this about him at the time. James is great as far as you go to his website, you go to CorbettReport.com and say for 9/11, okay? Everything is just so, I mean, this is, you know, where I can only dream of getting to one day. But everything organized, categorized, referenced, linked. The links have links. The references have references. You know, I mean, and it's just a smooth gliding. Oh, I want to go here. Okay, yep, and then back. Oh, it's just a great job. And he puts out a, you know, his corporate report, like a podcast, where, again, typically with guests, certainly the feather in his cap to date, in my opinion, has been 9/11. His work on that has been just absolutely fantastic. And I don't know if the truth movement would actually be where it is without him. Just tireless work. And again, straight shooter, very soft spoken, you know. So I got left about seven. Wow, going a little bit longer than I thought. Notice so far, too, with what I've listed off here, notice what's missing, right? Rush Limbaugh, Michael Savage, although he is breaking through a little bit, but Glenn Beck, he does some good things, but, you know, none of the mainstream guys. I wish I was putting some of them on here. I am very close. I listened to this guy, Jeff Koons. I don't know what his national or world level is. I don't think it's very big, you know, but he's on RKO here, 6 to 10 in the mornings. And he's as close to any, you know, he's still got, you know, very, he bashes Democrats and liberals, all, you know. But he's come as close as I've ever heard anyone in mainstream media to realizing that it's more than a Democrat-Republican thing, that it's an elite thing. Actually, I heard the words New World Order come out of his mouth. It was the first time I've ever heard that on, you know, like mainstream radio, for sure. But anyway, put that aside. But you know what? Anyone who ultimately goes along with the 9/11 narrative, to me, is a schmutz. And I just, like Glenn Beck, all right? Like I said, he does a lot of good things. But that's my litmus test. You know? And I get it, like, if, say, in like Glenn Beck's case, or whoever it is, insert name, I get it if you're not going to come out and talk about 9/11 truth, you know, whatever, you got your thing to protect, bullshit, but whatever. But don't then go and actually call the truth movement bullshit, because once you do that, well then, to me, you just got no credibility, all right? Not to just come out and call people in the truth movement crackpots and tinfoil hat-wearing conspiracy theorists, which they've all done, so... again, that's my litmus test. You know, got Bill O'Reilly, certainly. It's a big reason why, you know.
Fucking thing sucks!
Right, Bill, of course. Anyway, let's keep going on down the line here. STG report. I've kind of relatively recently with these guys, last 6 months, but just STG report on YouTube. I think he's got a blog as well. But one a week, two a week, really, really great reporting, great episodes, very interesting, well done, well produced. I mean, shit, you ain't getting fucking David Allen Coe on his, you know, while you're listening to him. But no, really, really smart dude right there. I don't actually know much about the guy, but he's really, the FTG report is something I look forward to. Talk a lot about gold and silver, and obviously subsequently the economy to go along with that. Chris Green, AMTV, on YouTube, AMTV. I like Chris. He's kind of a different personality all around, you know? Like, he puts out one or two reports a day. And I think he's an ex, like, Wall Street guy. And now he's just doing this. Pretty good following. I mean, I think his, you know, his reports will get 15,000 a day, maybe, views. So, yeah, that's pretty good. But, you know, he'll let loose, he'll rip it out, you know, I mean, he'll call Hillary Clinton a douche, which I like, you know, usually kind of more reserved, but he does get fired up, and, does provide some good reports. He stays on some things that, you know, like he was on the MH17 flight thing, you know. So when a lot of people tailed off, I guess, is what I'm saying. But Chris Green, AMTV. Let's move a little quicker now. And again, just names where you can jot down, you know, listen to the podcast again. Get to this point. Hit pause. Write these names down. Just look them up on YouTube and then save them and then come back. But the judge Napolitano. Oh, you got to listen to the judge, man. And I'm not talking about his stuff on Fox, although that's pretty good, you know. Even his reports on Fox are pretty good. But, you know, the judge has a website and writes a lot of essays. I like to call them essays, but articles, whatever. But the judge brings a great, interesting viewpoint, you know, obviously, especially where the law and the Constitution are concerned. Guy named Bill Still. Bill does like a 2-3 minute report every day, very much on the economy, on money. He's done a couple of full length documentaries, one of which was called like The Wizard. Ah, shit, I forget it now. But he breaks down The Wizard of Oz, and it's actually how it's all like one big metaphor for the Federal Reserve. You know, the yellow brick road is gold, and the Oz at the end is the Federal Reserve, and, you know, it's really cool, very, very cool. One day I'm going to have just like a strict, what I'm doing here, I'm going to do with, you know, good documentaries that I've seen, and just kind of cover them and go all over them. But anyway, Bill Still, like recently, he had a great interview with William Binney, the former NSA, top guy at the NSA who quit 10 years ago, 15 years ago, told them to stick it because he didn't like the direction they were going, you know. But, I mean, he was the Eric Snowden before Snowden, long before Snowden, too, coming out and whistleblowing on the NSA. Peter Schiff. You'll see him a lot of places. Actually, Stefan Molyneux will fill in for Peter Schiff on his podcast quite often. But All Economy, Peter's a bit of a blowhard, but he does bring some good economic insight, in my opinion. Greg Palast, good old school reporter. Greg Palast, look him up. I believe gregpalast.com. John Rappaport. I've got to spend a minute on John. John is a different, a different kind of personality, but he really brings some different stuff to the table. He's a little bit unorganized as far as his web presence is concerned, at least in my opinion. A little bit all over the place, but when there is some damn good John Rappaport books and you know, interviews with him out there, that, you know, John blows the lid off a lot of stuff. So, and he actually had a couple of interviews. I'm not sure which one was interviewing which, but this girl, this lady, Catherine Austin Fitz. Check her out, man. Catherine Austin Fitz. Just a unbelievable wealth of knowledge that this woman has. Again, more economy-based, more money-based. But you see where I'm getting at here? I mean, there's all these guys that, you know, heavy-duty, real journalism reporting. And all, you know, a lot of these people, insiders, have been there before, have been in Wall Street, have been at the top of companies. And they are now coming out and all saying how bullshit and phony and fake this is. And all warning about the upcoming and impending and very harsh collapse that's coming our way. Gotta mention Jesse the Body Ventura. Come on. Oh, yeah, Jesse. Got his own show now off the grid on, I think it's Aura TV. Daily, Monday through Friday, 10, 15 minutes long. I love the body, man. You know, again, do I agree with everything? No. But Jesse is all right. He's old school, and he gives a shit about America. That's what I know. And, you know, I think his track record speaks for itself when he was governor. He kicked lobbyists out of his office, and did, you know, I mean, his whole life, he's got Navy SEAL, wrestler, movie star, governor, you know, TV show host, everything. And there's whispers about, of course, Jesse Ventura for president in 2016, and he's got my vote if he runs. That's all I'll say about Jesse the Body Ventura. George Norrie with, Coast to Coast AM. You know, you can catch Coast to Coast AM, you know, whether you've heard of it or not. Late night, it's on pretty much every AM station across the country, or across the world, I should say. But, I mean, you want a wide variety of topics and stuff. You know, I think I have it on the description for my podcast. But, you know, we're going to be getting into some different stuff here. It's not all going to be about the big club and money and all that shit. You know, because we do want to start talking about the UFO phenomena and the origins of human history, which is just a fascinating subject that is, you know, seemingly, you'd think we'd have some of that stuff narrowed down, right? No way, not even close. And the stuff that's coming out and has come out in the last 10, 15 years, wow. Just makes you rethink everything about how we got to where we got to. And George Norrie, certainly at the head of the class of Coast to Coast AM. Gerald Celente, trendsjournal.com. He's a trends master, you know, forecasting news and events. And from what everything I can tell, he's pretty spot on about a lot of things. And, you know, just obviously another guy. I mean, he is a alt media whore, you know. Everyone loves Gerald. Very personable guy. He's been doing it for years and years and years. His Trends Journal has been around for 20 years. But everyone likes to get Gerald on for their interview, you know. So on Alex a lot, on RT a lot, on Greg Hunter, USA Watchdog, all this. He's on them all. And another guy, Max Kaiser. Max was another guy super high up in the finance world. You know, realized the big crock of steaming bullshit that it is. And I think he's got his own RT show now. So, again, you got to look up RT, Russian television. So, and again, there is... Well, let me bring her up, Abby Martin, who has her own show, Breaking the Set, on RT. Fantastic show. Abby is unbelievable. Not bad to look at either. But, I mean, the reporting this girl does is just, it's second to none. And, like, again, you put her at ABC or Fox, and get her in front of the president? Get her in front of some of these people? The shit starts turning around, folks. Webster Tarpley, you know, geopolitical extraordinaire. I mentioned him in the 9/11 in the Fed report. But a bunch of books out from Webster on 9/11 and many other subjects as well. Webster can be a bit, you know, odd, I guess, is a way to put it. But, you know, I like Webster. Good shit, you know. Joel Skousen, another guy I learned of through Alex. He has, God damn it, I don't have his website name right in front of me. I should, but I don't. But Joel Skousen, he's actually, you know, he's got a book that he promotes through Alex Jones about, you know, what to do, strategic relocation, that's what it's called. So, you know, about how to prepare and what to do for when the shit hits the fan. And Joel was head up in the military and something else I can't quite remember now, but, you know, old school, old guy, you know. And you just hear stuff from this guy, and then you look at his credentials, and he's, you know, it's hard not to take him very, very seriously. I'm going to end it here with one more. And this guy is actually dead, unfortunately. He died not long after 9/11, and the circumstances around his death are quite shady. But he actually predicted 9/11. He had a podcast going at the time, or a radio show going on at the time. His name, William Cooper. And you can spend the next couple of years just looking up Cooper material. And he wrote a book, Beyond a Behold a Pale Horse. But William Bill was creating a lot of waves back in the day. And he was military and law enforcement, I want to say. Anyway, Bill exposed a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff. And like I said, he did call out him and Alex Jones. Both predicted 9/11 before it hit. But, I mean, they both said a major attack. This was in a month or two of it happening. A major attack is going to happen in America. And it's going to be blamed on Osama bin Laden. But don't believe it. That's bullshit. That's exactly, pretty much verbatim what they said, each of them. So, you know. But anyway, jeez, I thought I was going to wrap up early, huh? Well, there you freaks have it. All sorts of names and tidbits and things to keep you busy beavers for the next week and until we meet again. So, why don't we do that? Why don't we meet again? Why don't we pick this up next week? I never even did say I did, obviously, hope you noticed, moved the show up an hour to 8 o'clock. I think I'm going to keep it there. I was sick of my ass rushing around it, getting out of work and everything else and trying to rush. So I like the 8 o'clock start time much better. I think we're going to keep it right here. You know, and obviously I can keep yapping for 2 hours every week. I never thought that that I could. You know, maybe we'll look into doing, I don't know, like a quicker something, maybe a quick hit thing during the week. I don't know. But keep tuning in. Front Row at the Freak Show. FrontRowAtTheFreakShow.com and at the Freak Show. You freaks have a good week. We'll see you next Monday. Bye.